No, not yet. I'll have to speak louder. I would like to ask everybody to silence their cell phone before we get started so that we won't have any cell phones going off. Well, I'd like to welcome everybody to the Laurel Board of Trade Candidate Forum tonight. My name is Bob Mignone, and I'm a board member of the Laurel Board of Trade. And I'd like to take a minute and identify some of the other members of the Board of Trade that are here. We have our current chairman, Bernie Robinson from PNC Bank here. Bernie, why don't you stand? We have our president, Marvin Rogers. We have, and he's with the Laurel Mill Playhouse. We also have Jan Abel, retired PNC, our treasurer. Our administrative coordinator is here. Maureen Rogers, Marvin's wife. And we have several other board people who are here. Lee Brangen is here. Audrey Studefant is here. And am I missing anybody? That's the Board of Trade who's in attendance. Thanks for coming. Our moderator this evening is going to be Pamela Hunter. This is Ms. Pam right here. She's a District of Columbia court employee, and she's an employee relations officer, and she's the president of the D.C. Courts Toastmasters Club. We have a lot of ground to cover tonight, but first I want to thank the City of Laurel and Laurel TV for televising tonight's event. Additionally, I'd like to recognize the Laurel Board of Trade for its role in helping to organize this evening's event. Briefly, the Laurel Board of Trade membership is mostly composed of Laurel-based businesses and has as its mission to further business and economic growth within the City of Laurel. Some of the events we sponsor as the Board of Trade is the Main Street Festival, which brings over 50,000 people to Laurel on the day of the festival. We sponsor an August Back to School backpack and school supplies distribution for Laurel area school children. We do Riverfest Family Fun Day and Car Show, which is intended to showcase our beautiful riverfront park. The Farmers Market, located on Main Street, runs from June through October. We do various business forums throughout the year. And coming next Thursday, we have the exciting Trick or Treat on Main Street, which if you haven't seen it, it's amazing. With this said, let me outline the ground rules for tonight's questioning. Each candidate will begin with a two-minute opening statement. We will then go into questions that Pamela Hunter will ask. Each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to the question and 30 seconds should there be a need for a follow-up or rebuttal. The candidates will be able to see a timer, which is right over here, and Audrey's going to work the timer, which will signal them as to how much time they have left. We will start the questioning with some pre-selected questions, and then we will be taking questions from the audience. Please find forms and pens available for you to write your questions. I'm going to ask the Board of Trade members to kind of help bring those questions up to us. For those watching the forum from their home, because this, again, is being televised, we have set up a special cell phone number for you to text your questions. And that number is 301-346-5926. Again, 301-346-5926. After all questioning is complete, each candidate will have 2 minutes for a closing statement. We also have some refreshments outside in the lobby, and we encourage the candidates and voters to gather there for further conversation at the completion of the evening. We have 7 candidates running for 4 positions. Our Mayor Craig Moe, as well as at-large Councilman Mike Lez, are running unopposed and have not been asked to attend. Although we have in attendance our at-large representative, Mike Lez, right here. Remember, you are registered to vote. If you are registered to vote in Prince George's County and live in the City of Laurel, you are automatically registered to vote in the city. Registered voters are either in Ward 1 or in Ward 2. You will be voting for 2 council persons representing your ward, as well as the at-large council person, Mike Lez, and Mayor Moe. I would now like each candidate to stand as I call your name. The candidates for Ward 1 are Ed Ricks, Valerie Nicholas. Paul DeWalt. Jeff Mills. The candidates for Ward 2 are Fred Smalls. Donna must be running late. And Mansoor Zia. Mansoor Zia is not participating tonight because he has the flu all earlier. And certainly wish him a speedy recovery. Four of these candidates, you can all be seated now. Four of these candidates will be elected November 3rd to a two-year term. I would now like to call on Valerie Nicholas for her opening statement.
Thank you so much. I thank everyone for coming. I've lived in the Laurel community since 2001, and I've been very active in the community. I was appointed, as most of you know, in June of 2011 to fulfill the vacant seat of Gail Snyder. I'm now completing my second term. Being in office now has been more of a continuation of what I was already doing in the community. I'm very visible. My home and phone numbers are very public, and residents continue to call me for assistance. It's been an honor for me to serve, and I would like to continue to serve with my city council colleagues as we strive to make the neighborhoods even better and improve the quality of life for all. Thank you.
We're now going to ask Mr. DeWalt for his opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you for everybody that came. Thank you for everybody that came tonight. My address is 422 Prince George Street. I've lived at that address for over 30 years. I worked for the City of Laurel Police Department for 20 years, and I retired from there as a police captain. For the past 2 years, I'm a retiree of the City of Laurel retirement system, and I will be until the day I die. During that 30-year period, I was honored to be part of numerous partnerships that were formed throughout the City of Laurel. These partnerships consisted of citizens, business owners, community leaders, employees, retirees, and anybody that visited our great city of Laurel. Also, during these partnerships, we were able to establish a lot of really, really good resources, both in the city and just outside the city. If elected to the city council, I promise you that I would utilize all these partnerships that I just explained to you and utilize the resources anytime there's a problem, issue, or concern by any of the citizens of Laurel. And I ultimately think that these factors will enhance not only public safety and the quality of life, but the transparency in our local city government. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeWalt. We will now have Mr. Fred Smalls to deliver his opening statement.
Thank you, and thank you all for coming out tonight. So why am I running for re-election? The best way I know how to support the city I've grown to love is to be of service to it. Laurel is at an important crossroads. Its ideal location between Washington and Baltimore make it a desired destination for businesses, young professionals, and families. I'm running for re-election to continue helping Laurel reach its full potential as a vibrant city in which every business and resident thrives. 2 years ago, Team Laurel focused on ensuring city residents were at the front of the line for jobs when a town center project was completed. We're proud to say that not only do city residents hold jobs at the center, but many of them are young people. 2 years ago, Team Laurel made a commitment to continue supporting our police department. We've kept that commitment by ensuring our officers have the tools they need to do their jobs effectively and safely. Team Laurel has worked to continue funding our city employee pension program even when budgets have been strained. I'm running because I believe Ward 2 residents deserve responsive leadership. And I will continue to answer your emails. I will continue to return your phone calls promptly. And I will always treat you with treat you and your concerns courteously and professionally. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smalls. We will now ask Mr. Jeff Mills for his opening statement.
Thank you. Thanks for everybody that came out tonight, and also that's looking at the Laurel TV. I am a volunteer for Laurel TV as well. And this year, over 400 women will die due to breast cancer. 700,000 elderly people will die due to Alzheimer's. And every 9 seconds in the United States, women are assaulted and beaten here in the United States. I am representing my mother, my grandmother, my sisters, my wife, my 3 daughters, my aunts, and the 13,137 women that populate the great city of Laurel. My name is Jeffrey Mills. I am your number one candidate for Award 1. I am Main Street. I am Laurel. And I again say that I am your number one candidate for the city of Laurel. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mills. We will now ask Mr. Ricks for his opening statement.
Thank you very much, and welcome to everyone. I really appreciate you coming out and being a part of this process. My name is H. Edward Ricks. I'm a lifelong resident of the city of Laurel. I'm a life member of the Laurel Volunteer Fire Department, the Laurel Rescue Squad, and I've been now on the city council. This is my fourth year, and I'm currently serving as president. We've had a very challenging time this past year. Things like the hospital closure, the railroad station closure. We've tried very diligently to be a part of the community and to take the community to these different projects and let them know exactly what we're doing in order to try and make these problems go away. We spent the day today in both Baltimore and here fighting for these particular projects. I bring to the council years of experience. I've worked for the court system in Washington, D.C. for 37 years in the family court. I know this city, born and raised here. I know Main Street. I know what it takes to make it vibrant again. And we're working very diligently to see that happen. Our CRA is very active in making sure that Main Street remains vibrant. We're making sure that our new town center remains vibrant. We've succeeded in that. We currently have over 3,000 housing units on the drawing board or under construction here in the city of Laurel. For these reasons and many more, I want to be here as a part of this to make it happen and make it successful, and that we all continue to be happy and one family in this city. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are now going to ask Crary for her opening statement.
Please excuse my tardiness tonight. I'm Donna Crary, and I've been on the council for 7 years now. I too am as interested in this council in keeping a full service hospital here in the city. I also have worked very hard with Mr. Ricks as president pro tem on the train station in keeping that stop in this town. Also with my other council members, we've worked very hard to ensure smart development in this town. In addition to the other duties as council person, I also am chair of the CRA, Community Redevelopment Authority here in town, which is also smart development. I would appreciate your vote, and thank you for the pastime that I have enjoyed on this council. Thank you.
Donna, I knew you were a little bit late, so you didn't hear some of the ground rules. We're going to start questioning now, and each person is going to have an opportunity for 1 minute to respond. If there's a need for a rebuttal, you'll have 30 seconds, and then there's a closing statement for 2 minutes. Now we're going to begin the questioning, Pam.
We're We're going to start with our first question, and we're going to ask Mr. DeWalt to answer first, and then I will call on each candidate in a predetermined order to respond to the same question. Ready? Yes. Please identify and explain your position on the planned closing of Laurel Regional Hospital as a full-service hospital. What actions or plans might you execute to restore a full-service hospital for the Laurel community?
I attended the last meeting of the hospital at the partnership hall that was put on by the United Healthcare Workers. At that meeting, there was a lot of passion and emotion by our community leaders. Mary Lehman spoke. She represents District 1 in Prince George's County. You could hear the passion and emotion in her voice of how we should keep the hospital a full-service hospital and it shouldn't be closed. Then the state delegate Pena Melnick spoke. She represents the 21st District, which is parts of Prince George's County and Anne Arundel County. And you could tell the passion and the emotion that came from her voice, which represents a lot of citizens. Mary Lehman represents all of Northern Prince George's County, and the state delegate represents almost all PG County and Anne Arundel County. Then Mayor Moe, who wasn't even supposed to speak, was in his jogging shorts, got up there. And you could see the passion and emotion that he represented at that meeting. Then about 12 or 15 citizens got up, a couple of them very elderly citizens. And they expressed the anger that our ambulance service could be delayed by 1.5 hours to 2.5 hours. And that's going to cost people their lives. So I would encourage people to support these three leaders because, as you know, Mayor Moe represents all the City of Laurel citizens. And I described what Mary Lehman represents and our state delegate represents. And we need to continue that support for them. And we need to, the latest PSIs that I looked at today, after they've tried to get an injunction on the hospital, the union's attorneys and two citizens of the City of Laurel. And and the PSAs today are saying to write and contact Governor Hogan. So that's the next step in this long journey, and it's a fight. And one thing we should get perfectly clear is that we should get the word to Rashern Baker that he's not wanted in Northern Prince George's County. He voted to close that hospital without the authority of its citizens. And we got to stress that to him that he's no longer wanted in the portion of county that's considered Laurel. Thank you.
I'm going to ask Ms. Nicholas to respond to the same question. Absolutely. Please identify and explain your position on the planned closing of Laurel Regional Hospital as a full-service hospital. What actions or plans might you execute to restore a full-service hospital for the Laurel community?
Thank you. I volunteered there as a volunteer chaplain for a number of years before I was actually hired as their volunteer coordinator. Because I'm employed there, I've had to recuse myself from action. However, that is my health provider is there, and I love the hospital. It's a community hospital. I support the council and the mayor and all of the legislators as they fight to keep it open as a full service hospital. Thank you.
Ms. Crary, please.
Thank you. I think in addition to what's already been said is it's not only engaging our local residents so that we send the letters. The legislators that we've mentioned, Jocelyn and Mary, they're on board. So as they've asked us, don't send the letters to them because that's falling on ears that are already supporting us. Send it to Rashern, send it to Governor Hogan, send it to the head of the health section of the legislature and the Mr. Sessions, who was head of MHMH for the state, who controls the CON, which is a certificate of need for the state of Maryland. What Dimensions is pulling, and we don't know if the county exec is involved. We can only assume he is by his silence. But we need to keep the heat on them. And by sending the engaging our constituents and keeping the heat on them, then we're going to get some results. And we're doing our meetings weekly, daily in some cases, with all the authorities that we can, so that we can get answers. Because Laurel's not going away. We're going to get those answers.
Mr. Mills.
Thank you. I brought a newspaper from the Washington Post. Very old, as y'all can see. And this is back in May 16, 1972. And this was when Governor Wallace was shot right here at the Laurel Station. And y'all can see this. I brought this for everyone to see. And when he was shot, it says right here in the paper that he had to be carried to the Holy Cross Hospital, which is 20 minutes away. And this is a fight, not just for us to fight, but as far as for the community to fight, because just as this governor here that was shot, right at the Laurel Shopping Center, this is our lives too, because we don't know what's going to happen to us when we walk out this door. And we have critical issues. We have an elderly center right on Main Street that I see almost every 2 days that an ambulance is driving there. And if we don't fight for this hospital, and I mean tooth and nail, that's going to be us that have to be traveled 20 minutes away. And that 20 minutes is very vital to our health, to our lives, to our family lives, and those who travel through the roads of Laurel. So we have to fight. We have to get down, and we cannot let our families down, our neighbors down, and those who travel the byways through Laurel. So I advise y'all to, you know, read the paper, and it's an actual fact. 20 minutes away that the governor had gotten shot. So you just ask, when you call the governors and ask them, you too could possibly get shot coming through Laurel, or whatever could possibly happen, what would you do?
Time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mills. We are now going to ask Mr. Ricks to respond.
Well, back in 1972, it may have been 20 minutes, but now it's 40. Because of 495 and the congestion on I-95 and those sort of things. What I would do, what I am doing, is I'm very supportive of 1199, the union of union workers over at the hospital. There are over 600 of those people over there. They're going to lose their jobs. We are supporting them in every way we can. There's legislation that's being proposed not only at a county level, but also in the state level. We are going to continue to support that legislation. We are going to meet with everybody that we can meet with in order to make sure that they understand that we're in this to win it. We're not going to back down from it. We're going to talk to the people just like we talked to today. We had a meeting here with the Secretary of Health for the state of Maryland this morning at 9:00. We met with him for over an hour and a half. We left here, we went to Baltimore, and met with the University of Maryland director and deputy director of health for the state of Maryland. We are going to continue to make every effort possible that we continue to bring these people to the table and make them understand that we are not going to accept anything but a full service 24/7 hospital in the city of Laurel. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ricks. And on this question, we will now hear from Mr. Smalls.
Thank you. As many of you know, I have served on the Board of Directors at Laurel Regional Hospital for 11 years. Three of those, the most recent three of those 11 years is as chairman. In addition to that, I served on the Dimensions Corporate Board as well as their Finance Committee. I, along with one doctor from Laurel Regional Hospital, were the two no votes when the corporate board voted to close Laurel Regional Hospital. I want to work to continue empowering our community, you, to speak out against the closure of this hospital. As has already been stated, closing our hospital would have a devastating effect, obviously on the public health for this community, on our emergency services as well. So it takes a real strong grassroots efforts as well as working with all of our elected officials to make sure that we work collectively to keep our hospital open. It's not going to be an easy fight. It's not been an easy fight so far. But if we persevere, we will prevail. I feel strongly about that. And having served for 11 years,
time,
I certainly know from the inside what does go on and has gone on at that hospital. Thank you.
For our next question, we will start with Ms. Nicholas. Main Street as a business district has been struggling for many years. What concrete plans to enhance business and attract new growth type business would you offer or promote?
Well, currently we've had over 31 new businesses that have been started since 2014. We have offered a lot of grant programs for new businesses that come in and signage programs for them to be able to have startup funds. There is a variety of businesses that are on the street, and we're welcoming new businesses and looking to continue to increase the growth there on Main Street.
Thank you. Ms. Crary.
We just opened C Street Flats, which increases the pedestrian traffic on Main Street. And that is now, I believe, 100% full. When we were down there a month ago, it was 98% full. In addition to that, we've designated a theater district. Anytime you increase pedestrian traffic, it comes up to the new business. I would disagree with the initial premise that business has been going down on Main Street. It's actually been going up during the past few years. In addition, we've created the Community Redevelopment Authority, and we've been buying properties up and down Main Street, and we've also been entertaining developers' proposals for different businesses on Main Street and to purchase some of these properties. In addition to that, we've had a Main Street manager that has worked with the grants and attracting new businesses, and it's just improving all the time. Thank you.
Mr. Smalls.
Thank you. In addition to what Councilwoman Crary has stated, the city had what I'll call a sort of quasi Main Street manager, Main Street advocate, who worked to direct businesses to Main Street to make sure that Main Street had the proper mix, or let me not say proper mix, but a desired mix of businesses that would bring foot traffic to Main Street. While we no longer have a person in that position, I think that is something that if I'm fortunate enough to be reelected, that's something I would advocate for, that we have someone that is working on behalf of the city, but also on behalf of the businesses on Main Street to help promote and generate new business opportunities for that street. I travel around a lot to main streets around Maryland. And I work in Annapolis, and I see how vibrant and busy the Annapolis Main Street is. I want that for our Main Street also.
Time.
And I certainly want to see us have more activity on Main Street after 5 o'clock.
Thank you. Mr. Rex.
Well, we've all been working very hard to see that Main Street stays vibrant. We, as you've heard, we've got the CRA that's been purchasing property. We know that parking is a problem on Main Street. We hear that from our residents. We've been working with some of the businesses there to see that they pull their cars off of Main Street and put them in the back of their businesses so that there's more parking for their particular businesses. We've actually, the CRA has purchased a piece of property in the 500 block of Main Street. And there was an old house on it. The house has been torn down, and we're getting ready to put it to make a parking lot out of that particular piece of property. It'll carry about 20 cars, which will then serve Olive on Main, will serve the churches on Main Street, will serve Oliver's on Main Street, the theater, the playhouse. And these are the types of things that we're doing in order to make Main Street as viable as we possibly can make it. There have been grant programs that we've added. So if you wanted to paint your front of your building, we've got matching funds that we can give you to do that. So with those types of things and more that we're going to be doing, we're going to continue to see Main Street grow. Thank you.
Mr. Mills.
Thank you. Well, I said, and I say it again, I am Main Street. I am a business owner on Main Street, and I do represent the business owners on Main Street. And a lot of the Main Street businesses say that the council basically has let them down as far as financing. Now, we're talking personal financing. The business owners say that the council don't even shop on Main Street. So we have to, as myself, as a business owner and other business owners, we all have to collectively, we are Laurel, and we have to funnel our money. Our money needs to circulate in Laurel, not just one time, but it needs to circulate business from business, banks to banks. And as far as the taxes are deterring a lot of prominent business owners to purchase property on Main Street due to the taxes. So I think if we can kind of balance out the taxes and reduce that, then maybe we can bring more business owners on Main Street instead of the all of the vacant buildings.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Rebuttal. I somewhat resent the fact that anybody to be on Main Street. I was born and raised on Main Street. I travel through Rainbow Floors, PNC Bank. I go to the Java House. I go to Laurel Meat Market. I go to the post office. I go to Minuteman Press. So I resent the fact that you say that I don't, as a council member, spend my money on Main Street.
Seconds.
In what capacity do you represent the business on Main Street? What is your title?
I own two businesses on Main Street, Out and About Advertising, and I also own CDL Book Club, where the CDL Book Club, I am training the residents of Laurel to have a backup plan. And that backup plan is to change their regular license into a commercial license. And that is, on Mondays, we have at least over 400 people. Mondays, come and see for yourself. Mondays at 6 p.m., where we bring people from far as New Jersey that come here for the training. So
time.
This money that they're bringing is also helping Main Street.
Just a reminder to all of the candidates that we have 1 minute to respond to the initial question and 30 seconds for rebuttal.
I'll do this in 30 seconds. Not only do I shop on Main Street, I direct other shopping opportunities on Main Street. I shop at Rainbow Florist, at Laurel Meat Market, and other establishments on Main Street, but I do in my capacity on my job also direct some of the business that I'm allowed to conduct to businesses also on Main Street. So I think I do my share of shopping and directing foot traffic to Main Street as well.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Nichols.
Thank you. I'd also just like to echo my council members. I actually shop on Main Street as well. I see Gracie's boutique owner here in the audience, and I actually bought a beautiful outfit from there for my birthday. I shop at the Laurel Meat Market, Minuteman Press. We go to the restaurants quite often. I direct all of my friends and my church members and colleagues at the hospital to go there as well. It's a fun place. I grew up in a small town. The hometown feel is what I love, and I'm done. Thank you.
Now, on the original question, we still have to hear from Mr. DeWalt.
Could you repeat the question, please? I kind of forgot.
I thought I may need to do just that.
Thank you.
So Main Street, as a business district, has been struggling for many years. What concrete plans to enhance business and attract new growth-type business would you offer or promote?
I think the most pressing issue right now is saving our train stop. I think that's the heart and soul of that the whole business district on Main Street. When you just had somebody quoted the C Street Flats coming in, the president spoke at one of the meetings, and he said that's one of the top promotional items of the people moving into C Street Flats so that they could walk to the train station. I think that's vital that we fight for that, just as we're fighting to keep the hospital alive. I'm not a business person. I don't know much about business. I would go to the experts, Bill Miles, Matthew Coates, Bob Minion, people that own stores, and ultimately the Board of Trade. That's what they're set up for, to own businesses. And I would work closely with them and go with their recommendations on how to get businesses to Laurel. Now, if you want to talk about safety along Main Street, I could help with that.
Time.
Do I get to go any more than that? Please.
Thank you, Mr. DeWalt. Rebuttal? 30 seconds.
I still call you Cap. So it mentioned about the saving the stop. That's a serious issue, but I actually want to be realistic about saving a stop that's already dead. If you Google on Google Maps today, right now, if you do, you will see that right on Google Maps, there is a marked train stop already set right on your Google map. They've been digging for a year now. With me being a council member, I am a proactive guy. I'm not a reactive guy.
Time.
Thank you.
Do I get to rebuttal that?
Be kind and say yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I know that when people or businesses move into a community, their top priority is usually about safety. And I would propose along Main Street supporting a police officer, community police officer working day work and evening hours during Main Street so that he could not only watch the speed on Main Street, but also enhance crosswalk safety. He can also visit every business on Main Street and the senior citizen home and find out what their concern is. And somebody mentioned after 5 p.m., a lot of the seniors that I talk to don't feel that Main Street is very safe after 5 p.m. And that would enhance ultimate safety along Main Street when you have a police officer parking a marked cruiser on the street, plus walking a footbeat up and down Main Street, including with Lafayette Avenue, who is part the a business district down there, too.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Speaking of safety, one of my concerns is I would like for us to just kind of open our eyes, and I actually have four eyes, and I've been saying for quite a while that if I really say that Main Street has been neglected. If you go to the town center, where it's only been there not even a year, that there is a police car that's always parked by, Laurel police car, always parked by the movie theater. Always. So if we could have that in our neighborhoods and on Main Street, speaking of safety, because I've been
time.
Asking, I'll bring it up later. Thank you.
Rebuttal. That police car is under contract with that movie theater, and the police officers that are working over that theater are on overtime, and they're being paid by the movie theater. The cruiser is parked there strictly because it's the officer's take-home cruiser. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move to the next question, and we will start with Ms. Crary. As you know, we have a large indigent population around the Main Street area. As a result, newcomers and visitors are sometimes intimidated by their presence. How can the city further reach out to this population and help improve their situation?
There are moves afoot at this time from private entities in the city. The problem lots of times is the city doesn't have a large enough budget to have a housing department. That's something that, and it's a question that we answer lots of times from our constituents. That's a county issue that has a huge housing department. We have to reach out to them to receive monies from them. In addition to that, we've reached out to individuals in the community that are interested in developing housing in the city for these individuals. And to that extent, as much as I can say publicly at this time, I will end my answer.
Thank you. Mr. Smalls.
We all know that the city has worked very closely with our local churches to support as best we can their efforts to house or provide shelter, I'll say, and feed where they can many of our indigent residents. As Councilwoman Crary stated, we don't have the capacity to have the social services that are provided by the county, but we do through LARS and other organizations certainly provide support as best we can to those organizations. One of the other things that the city has made a requirement of is any new housing projects, that there are set-asides in those new housing projects for people of low to moderate income. So there are efforts. Are we doing all we can do? Perhaps not.
Time.
But we certainly are working to make an effort, and our efforts are ongoing.
Thank you. We're now going to ask Mr. Ricks to respond.
Thank you. 15 years ago, or maybe 20, Mayor Robinson asked me to chair a task force on homeless here in the city. I did that successfully. We looked and met with a lot of the homeless people at different locations, including Lars, Elizabeth House, and other locations around the city where these people were gathering. We gathered as much information to try and figure out exactly what it was these people were trying to accomplish in their lives. We tried to figure out exactly what we could do to assist them. I'm sorry to say that that report never went anywhere. What I am happy to say right now is the city has a vision. Mayor Moe has a vision that we've all bought into. And as Mrs. Crary alluded to, we can't really talk too much about it, but I can tell you that it is inclusive of everything that we would want in a mental health and homeless shelter. It's inclusive.
Time.
It's inclusive of bringing in the different agencies that would help these people in the homeless. It would give them places to go to live and to bathe and to live some kind of a productive life. I hope to be able to share more with that in the future.
Thank you. Mr. DeWalt.
I believe it's going to take a collaborative effort between Prince George's County, the City of Laurel, Howard County, and Anne Arundel County. If elected to the council, I would love to sit on that board. If you walk down the path of Riverfront Park, you'll see the tents and the homemade sheds and stuff over in Howard County. If you go down by Lafayette Avenue and you go down along 198, you'll see those tents and shelters and things over in Anne Arundel County. The attraction for the homeless in Laurel is the Fish House, which they walk noon and during dinner times, which they cross through Main Street, they cross Lafayette Avenue, and they cross 198. That's the reason for the police officer during day and evening hours. If they do become a nuisance in that area with the business owners, that police officer can identify them. This is why that officer is going to have to be very unique. He can identify them, get to know them, and find out a little bit better about him. And he can report to somebody that's in charge of that to try to get them. I actually registered a homeless guy. He lives in an apartment building that but he lives in an apartment building right there on Prince George Street, and he told me him and his wife was homeless in Howard County, and they didn't separate from each other during the winter hours because the establishments to go to, they split the males and the females. And I said, well, how did you get off the street? He said, a police officer in Howard County told me and drove me over to Lars. And shortly after that, within a month or two, him and his wife were able to get their own apartment, and she drove up in a car. But that's the type of things I believe that we need to address the homeless, and that's part of that plan of having that police officer on Main Street so that he can collaborate with them, who can collaborate with a council person or anybody that's assigned to that task force.
Thank you.
Rebuttal. Prince George's County has their own facility, and it's about 30 minutes from here. They don't want anything to do with our people up here. But what we would do when our plan is to bring the Prince George's County people to Laurel so that they will service our population. Howard County doesn't want to do anything with us because they're building their own multi-million dollar operation over on Route 1 in the Route 1 corridor. So the plan that Mayor Moe has and that this council is buying into is going to serve all those particular people with the church's help.
Time.
Thank you.
Ms. Nicholas.
Yeah, thank you so much for asking that question. In January of this year, there was an article in the Laurel Leader about me that I feed the homeless. I've been providing services to the homeless for the last 21 years. I actually have a food pantry in my home. The focus is not the food. The focus is to gain their trust, to connect them with services. I work very closely with Lars. They actually send me quite a few of their referrals in providing services to them. I also work very closely with the churches with their winter shelter in terms of providing temporary housing for them. I will continue to work closely with the Department of Social Services and the city as we develop ways to improve and end the homelessness issue here in our community.
Thank you. Mr. Mills.
Thank you. I've been working with the homeless since 1995, before I even moved to Laurel. And there's a homeless shelter, there's two homeless shelters in Sea Pleasant, Maryland, right off of Addison Road. There's one for the men, there's one for the women. And my thing, when I moved here, I realized that there is the same situation where I grew up. There's homeless and there's homeless here. And here, they're not in the shelters. Here, they're in tents and living off the riverfront. I personally, I don't fear men, I don't fear animals. I only fear God. And I go down into the tents. I go down and talk to them. But not only I Not only do I talk to them, but I work with the one-stop center. They just moved off of Mercantile Lane in Largo. But I train them. I train them to have their commercial, to get their license, to get their commercial license, to be get employed, to that, so they can earn money, so they can also become business owners.
Time.
So I train them to not only be employers, but employees. So that's what I do, and I work closely with them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next question, we're going to start with Mr. Mills. Howard County is proposing a large mixed-use community 2,500 feet up the tracks from our existing train station. Howard County has proposed the construction of a new train station to service the new community. Because of this, there is a discussion on closing our train station. Do you agree or disagree with the proposed closing? And if you disagree, what actions can be taken to disrupt this plan?
I don't want y'all to be upset with me, but I do disagree. I think, like I said before, the stop is dead. Look on Google Maps and see for yourself. It is dead. So therefore, I mean, when you ride down Route 1 since a year ago, you saw that the work being done. But now, just recently, you want to save a stop. We have to be proactive and not allow these type of situations to happen. We have to be proactive as far as the hospital. If I worked at the hospital, I would have, and I knew that that hospital was closing. I don't represent myself here. I represent the whole community of Laurel. I would have quit, and I would have let my community know. I say it again. I would have quit, and I would have let my community know because the situation is serious. Now, as far as the stop, I say the stop is dead.
Time.
It's going to be like the town center down there. That money will come into PG County. That money will come into Laurel. But what we have to do is we have to develop at that stop. We can use that stop and redevelop that stop. And that's what we should do.
Thank you, Mr. Mills. Mr. DeWalt.
I believe we should save our stop, and I believe it is alive and well right now. Howard County is the development they're proposing is huge, which brings in a lot of money. We're the underdogs in this one. We have over 800 commuters to come to that stop in Laurel. When you got a train stop where businesses are moving into the Main Street area based on saving that stop and walking to the train station, that's very, very important. And I think that's the heartbeat of Main Street. And if we lose that stop, it's going to knock Main Street really down. But it is a fight. It's like the hospital fight. You have to get a lot of the politicians involved. You have to write letters and you have to protest, just like they're doing at the hospital. If it takes legal action, then you should use legal action. I believe it's alive. I believe it's a fight worth fighting, and I believe it's a fight that we can win, and we should never stand back from that fight.
Thank you. Nicholas.
Yes. The Laurel stop is very much alive. It has 131 years of history. It was built in 1884. For myself, as a retired federal employee, I rode the MARC train downtown to Union Station to go to LaFont Plaza for over 10 years. We will continue to fight to save our stop. Save our stop.
Ms. Crary.
Would you repeat the question?
I certainly would.
Thank you.
Howard County is proposing a large mixed-use community 2,500 feet up the tracks from our existing train station. Howard County has proposed the construction of a new train station to service the new community. Because of this, there is a discussion on closing our train station. Do you agree or disagree with the proposed closing? And if you disagree, what actions can be taken to disrupt this plan?
wholeheartedly disagree. And this action, I believe, Mr. Les, when he was president, we started 8 years ago at least working on this. And then Mr. Smalls became president. Then I became president, and we've all been fighting for at least 8 years on this. The project lay dormant in Howard County all these years. Now they're starting with phase one, and all of a sudden, lo and behold, they popped up with, let's close the Laurel train stop. There's over 850 commuters every single day. We aren't laying down on the job. We've been fighting daily, Mr. Ricks and I and the rest of the council members, and it's not going to close, and it'll be over Mr. Ricks and I and the rest of the council bodies if it does. Thank you very much.
Mr. Smalls?
The Laurel train stop is a historic train stop. Along with my colleagues, we have worked tirelessly with the community to get the word out that we're not standing for that train to stop. And I have talked with one-on-one with legislators in Annapolis. I've talked with members of the Department of Transportation who are in high-level positions who are supporting our efforts to keep our train station open. And as was stated, we're not going to rest until this matter is settled and settled in favor of keeping our station open.
Thank you. Mr. Ricks.
The mayor works for the Maryland Department of Transportation, so he has to recuse himself on this particular issue. So therefore, it falls to myself and Ms. Crary, the president and pro tem. A little bit of history. I don't know whether very many of you know. I know probably Mr. Floyd knows it. But actually, when Lincoln passed away and was assassinated, Lincoln's funeral train took one of the longest funeral trips in the history of the United States, and it came through Laurel. That station is part of our blood. Our mere fact that the city was established by mills that were on the Patuxent River, where the products came in by rail, went up Main Street, were produced, the products were produced, went brought back down Main Street, put on rail cars, and sent to destinations. We are fighting daily to see that that train stop stays there. We've been meeting diligently with senators, delegates, council people, and the state itself. We meet at least once a week to discuss things and to solve problems and to make sure that we are protected and save that stop. It'll not go away, I promise you.
Rebuttal.
30 seconds, please.
I would like to say that my family, we catch the MARC train right here in Laurel. I just want to make it clear that they're digging. They're building in Howard County. And if this stop leaves, what we have to do is ask ourselves, ask as far as council, as far as neighbors, what is the actions if it does leave? What are we going to do? So this is business. Now, this is change. And there's only one business that's on Main Street that had advertised as far as using the MARC train. And 2,500 feet up the road is walking distance. But we have to have a plan to use that MARC train station if it does leave.
Thank you, Mr. Mills. Thank you. We have another rebuttal from Mr. Ricks.
The process thickens because, as we know here in the city, and this is the way I see it right now, the racetrack has 1,000 building units. That's a negative because the state of Maryland does not know of that 1,000 how many people will take the train. Laurel City now has 1,006 housing units that are being built at Hawthorne Place by the bowling alley. That is an unknown figure for us as well.
What we do know is that the Laurel train station, as it sits today, has 850 customers every day. And
time.
So we're, may I finish? So what we're fighting for is to make sure that the state understands that it's not Laurel they're going to bother. They're going to bother Howard County and leave us alone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
30 seconds. Thank you.
In my political travels going door to door, there's numerous homes where I go that have Save Our Stop signs. And people are very passionate and emotional when it comes to that issue. And seeing that and being a politician, that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to follow what the people want. And the people in Laurel want to save that stop. So you have to do everything in your power to try to save that stop.
Thank you.
30-second rebuttal. 30-second rebuttal.
30-second, then we'll move on.
Okay. When something is dead, you cannot revive it. And so with as far as this stop, yes, we're passionate about it. And please, don't get me wrong. We would have to use that location for something that will prosper for us as well. So if it does go to the Laurel racetrack is going to help us along with a new development. Along, but keeping
time
what's historic about the track.
Thank you.
The money is not coming to Laurel. The money is going to the Mark train.
Thank you, Mr. Mills.
Thank you.
Rebuttal. Let me just add real quickly that our efforts to save the stop is also complemented by development efforts that are being planned for that stop with the stop operating. So it's not as if there are no efforts to continue developing that stop area, because there is a very, very, very vibrant plan that has been presented to this community that would enhance the stop, providing both retail, residential, and commercial opportunities and options at a operating train stop in Laurel.
2-minute rebuttal. That station is anything but dead. It's alive and it's well.
Thank you. Our next question, and we will start with Mr. Smalls. As the metropolitan area has grown, the impacts on traffic on Route 1 and Main Street had a huge effect on our area. Pedestrians are often at risk. What ideas or changes might you implement to help relieve or control the situation?
Understanding that Route 1 is not a corridor that is controlled by the city, we do work very closely with developers who have plans to develop along Route 1 within the city limits, to encourage them to work with Department of Transportation to make enhancements to Route 1 that will ease traffic. As long as I've lived here in Laurel, which has been 20 plus years, Route 1 has always been a corridor for residents to avoid, particularly on Friday evenings and Saturdays. All you have to do is drive up and down Route 1 during rush hour, and it's horrendous. So we will continue to work with Department of Transportation, MDOT, work with our development community as they are working to develop properties along Route 1 to encourage projects that will help ease some of the traffic congestion that we have there.
Thank you. Mr. Ricks.
Well, we all realize that there is an issue with that. What I've been doing is that I have, as my been meeting with MDOT about the railroad situation and bringing and making some really pretty good contacts over there about some of the things that we have here in the city that are creating problems. By working with MDOT, we've just received the other day part of our traffic study, our TIS, that is allowing us to participate with the state of Maryland in a more of a regional approach to traffic congestion. Before we got into this process, when the three districts, 3, 5, and 7, come together right at the Prince George's, Anne Arundel, and Howard County line, those districts never talk to one another. So what we have done successfully is now we have made the Maryland Department of Transportation take more of a regional approach and look at the different jurisdictions and plan effectively from that particular perspective. Now, what that's allowed the city of Laurel to do.
Time.
May I finish, please? Thank you. What that has allowed the city of Laurel to do is to bring the Maryland Department of Transportation to the city and study the different intersections of Route 1 in Maine, 198, as it flows through Laurel and to different destinations. So we are saving our tax money here in this city by using the Maryland state tax money.
Thank you. Mr. Mills.
Well, my background is with the State Highway Administration, and I know that pretty much there needs to be another survey being done as far as to widen the road. I mean, there's been several times that the road has been widened, and basically that's just what needs to be done. The roads need to be widened a little more. You may have to even do away with some of the median areas, and pretty much that's going to have to be it as far as it just needs to be surveyed, widened, and because right now there's a lot of traffic on Route 1, especially during rush hour. So you need to just widen the roads up some more.
Thank you. Ms. Nicholas.
Thank you. And just echoing what my colleague Fred and Eddie said, we're looking at the various studies, and we're also looking at the timing of the traffic signals, but keeping a focus on pedestrian safety would be on the crosswalks.
Thank you. Ms. Crary.
Thank you. In addition, every developer that comes before us as city council right now, we're looking at bike paths, we're looking at pedestrian walkways, pedestrian friendly, traffic impact studies. In addition, the state has never looked at, as Mr. Ricks alluded to, regional impact studies. And if there was any area that begged for it, it's the city of Laurel, because we have four counties that come together here. You can't, as Howard County looks at, stop your impact studies at the edge of Howard County. Until Mr. Ricks and I came into the discussions with the state highway, with the Maryland Transportation Authority, they weren't looking beyond, and there's 31 intersections that are going to be impacted, and there's going to be millions of dollars now put into intersections in the city of Laurel because of the actions that we've put forward with the state highway and the signal timing, which is all going to affect. It's not an island. Everything that we do just has a ripple effect throughout the city of Laurel.
Thank you. Mr. DeWalt.
Could I have that question again, please?
Absolutely. As the metropolitan area has grown, the impacts on traffic on Route 1 and Main Street have had a huge effect on our area. Pedestrians are often at risk. What ideas or changes might you implement to help relieve or control the situation?
Well, as a citizen of Laurel, I guess I can only recommend that we educate the public on taking alternative routes throughout the city when the congestion's the worst. But as a council member, I guess then I could get the resources with state highways and get the information that I need to make a concrete proposal for that. But on crosswalk safety and pedestrian safety, I went through a 10-week school at Northwestern University Center for Public Safety, and my staff study was on crosswalk safety. and I did Main Street as my staff study for that. And those lights that are at 5th and Main are about 7-8 years way past the time that I recommended them to be on there. We should increase that probably 2 or 3 more of those lighted crosswalks. And even a better crosswalk is the one where you hit the button and along the roadway it actually lights up. Because most people, when they're driving, they're not looking above. They're looking, as according to my statistics and my staff study, they're looking either straight ahead or left and right or down. And these are much more visible even in the daylight hours. And through our speed cameras that can be used for public safety and equipment and training, that would be the ideal thing. At least down by B Street in Main, and one at 4th in Main, and possibly one up at 6th in Main, which would enhance that crosswalk safety. Also on 198, what we need to do is educate the Hispanic population into not crossing in the middle of the road. We actually have to do educational programs and flyers in Spanish, and we need to get those crosswalks a lot greater lit, because the public and the motorists see those lit crosswalks a lot better. But crossing in the middle of the road down there on 198, where we had most of those fatal accidents, are the top priority.
Thank you. With all due respect, in the interest of time, I would like to get a couple of citizen questions on the floor. And so if you would indulge me and forego the rebuttal, I will raise questions that have not been previously addressed through the questions that have been asked already. So we have a question from the floor. Please explain your vision for Laurel over the next 10 years. How will you support increasing the city limits south of Conti Road? Reference the Conterra project at Maryland 200 Expressway. And we're going to start on the end and work our way down. Ms. Nicholas. Sure. Please explain your vision for Laurel over the next 10 years. How will you support increasing the city limits south of Conti Road? Reference the Conterra project at Maryland 200 Expressway. Your vision for Laurel over the next 10 years, and how will you support increasing the city limits south of Conti Road? Reference the Conterra project and Maryland 200 Expressway, excuse me.
How many new businesses will come in terms of regulating traffic regulations there, looking at studies, making sure that there is a balance as we develop each of those projects.
Ms. Crary.
I don't envision a Conterra coming into the city. They will stay in the county, and I think their plan is to become a city in themselves. We've already extended the city boundaries, and we're adding a hotel and residences in the area. They're already coming out of the ground. I don't believe they've broken ground on the hospital yet. I envision a full-service hospital at the Conti Road in Van Dusen, and developing that campus into a specialty hospital, either for rehab or joint replacement or hip replacement, something like that. And the, I don't know if you'd call it assistant adjoining development that would go along with that, from drug stores to equipment that would complement a hospital such as that.
Mr. Smalls?
I support smart development. Smart development doesn't necessarily mean that we increase our city limits just to incorporate more land or property into the city. It has to be a benefit to the residents and businesses of our city. The city has taken over the years great pride in not actually actively going after properties that are outside the city limits, but looking at annexation a request that will be of a benefit to the city, as well as the possibility of those properties that are seeking to be annexed into the city. In a 10-year vision, I certainly would see us working together, as we stated earlier, with MDOT, Department of Transportation, to improve traffic circulation through our city. Envision seeing us making our city streets more walkable and ensuring that that we would just adhere to smart development, smart growth options as we look to seek out opportunities for our city to grow.
Thank you. Mr. Ricks.
I concur that we do have to focus on smart growth, but I also think that adding green to that phrase means a lot to me. I think that the Conti Road corridor is being developed in such a way that I think it's going to make us very, very happy. I took the opportunity with Mrs. Crary a couple weeks ago to invite Mr. Scott Pimento from the Maryland Department of Transportation Highways to come out and visit Laurel, to understand rather than see it on paper, to actually see the different roads and the structures that we're building within the city limits of Laurel, so that he will have a better picture of exactly what we're doing and what he's doing and how we impact one another. I think these types of things, this kind of communication with the different agencies that we have to deal with, will go a long way to make sure that our developments are done in such a fashion that it serves everyone's needs.
Mr. Mills.
I think that we can also add to the Conterra development right there at the corner of Conti and Van Dusen. That property is Laurel's and further down, a little past the hospital. With new development that's going on in that area, if we can add to that construction that's going on while they're building, maybe we can find a developer that can add so that we can benefit for, you know, as far as Laurel benefiting from that Conterra development. So I really think that we should have some type of development right there, Conti and Van Dusen. It's a lot of land right there that we could possibly use, and also the land that Laurel already possesses.
Thank you. Mr. DeWalt.
I would have to refer to back to my initial opening statement, where my vision would be to keep these valuable partnerships going at all times, utilizing all the resources that you establish to enhance quality of life, public safety, and the most important is the transparency in our government. And as these issues come on a one-on-one basis, then make sure that my partnerships and the citizens and the community know about these projects that are coming in and how they're going to impact the city and get their opinion on them and then move forward from there.
Okay, we're now going to ask each of the candidates to provide us with a closing statement, and that would be in alignment with the 1 minute time frame. So if you would begin to gather your thoughts very quickly. I'm going to this time start in the middle with Mr. Ricks. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming out and joining us, and I really appreciate nice seeing you again. I've been serving on the council now for the past 4 years. I've tried my best to be a person that gets to the city, to understand the city, to work for the city, and to make sure that we thrive in such a way that we can move forward. It's been an honor to serve, and I hope and pray that you will return me to office. Thank you.
Mr. Mills.
Thank you. Again this year, I'd like to make my statement by saying again that this year over 40,000 women have died due to breast cancer, 700,000 elderly women have died due to Alzheimer's, and every 9 seconds in the United States, women have been assaulted or beaten. And again, I represent my mother, my grandmother, my sister, my wife, my 3 daughters, my aunts, and the 13,137 women that populate the great city of Laurel. My name is Jeffrey Mills.
I am Main Street. I am Laurel, and I wish to bring development, new development to Laurel, and I am actually a proactive person, and I am not a reactive person. I wish to be your council member here in Ward 1, and I promise you a great job.
Thank you. Mr. Smalls.
I want to thank you all for coming out tonight. We have to continue working on the basics, providing world-class service to our residents, ensuring a fiscally responsible and transparent government, and ensuring our neighborhoods are safe. As a city, we have not reached our full potential and will not reach our full potential unless every citizen feels empowered to participate in local government. We have to work together to find the best solutions. And I'll repeat that. We have to work together to find the best solutions to city challenges. And I will always remember that every voice in our city matters. I hope you found my service to the city over the past several years effective, and it would be an honor to continue to serve you. Thank you.
Ms. Crary.
I don't do well with the I did this, I want this. And one of the most attractive things about coming on the city council is this is a team, and we've worked together for years now. We work very hard. We all have daytime jobs, and we addition have a second full-time job, and that's serving you on the city council, in addition to many long weekends. And I was discussing this with Mr. Smalls the other day, because oftentimes you come in and it's, I'm running for office, I want to do this for you. It's not I, it's all of us. In addition, the weakest member of our team is a citizen we can't reach, because if we can't reach a citizen, they can't participate. And as Mr. Smalls said, if they aren't participating, then they aren't a part of the solution. Thank you.
Mr. DeWalt.
Everyone knows that Maryland Special Olympics is near and dear to my heart. Well, every year when we did the torch run, we would run down Route 1, we'd make a right on Main Street, and at Laurel Fuel, Richard Cocoon and Susan Peacock would usually be there with American flags. They put one up on a crane once, and they'd applaud all the runners. And we would end up at the American Legion, and the American Legion was fortunate enough to supply all the food and beverages that we needed at that time at no cost. During that time, Richard Cocoon and Susan Peacock would donate in my name to Special Olympics very generously. So if I am elected to the city council, I'm going to donate my entire salary to Operation Second Chance, and I'll read what Second Chance is. It was founded in getting wounded combat veterans out of the hospital and away from their caregivers for a short period of time to help in the aid and recovery of their well-being and physical stresses that are put on them on a daily basis. That's where my salary would go. They take them out. Richard takes them out all the time, takes them fishing, hunting, and he shows me these pictures of these wounded warriors with prosthetic legs, prosthetic arms. He even got one guy up on a water ski, which was awesome. So that's where my entire salary would go. Thank you.
Finally, we'll hear from Ms. Nicholas.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming out tonight. I've been in the community a very long time, and I try my best to serve with integrity and character. What I have found is people don't care what your title is. They just want to know that you care. And just making yourself available to people to address their needs, to be their voice here at City Hall is an honor. I won't say anything else about what I've done and this and that. I just say to believe in me and to put me back in office again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, that concludes our forum tonight. Hopefully you agree that it was very enlightening. I'd like to thank Pam for doing the questioning. I know we have a tremendous group of candidates.
why